Okay, democracy. Democracy promotes freedom. Freedom is good. So, we're all done. No, we're not all done. Today we're actually going to start several weeks of talking about democracy. There are, of course, other ways you might organize your political community or your state, but democracy is fairly popular here in the U.S. It is fairly popular among political philosophers. In fact, if I had to characterize it, I would say that in Western political philosophy, the dominant view right now is that only democracies could possibly be good states. So, understanding a bit about what democracy is, what it means, and some of the different theories about it will help give us some structure for what we're going to talk about for the next few weeks of the class. So today we're going to talk a little bit about just laying the groundwork for the concept, and then a bunch about why it is exactly that people have become so convinced that democracy is a good thing, possibly the only good way to organize a state. Because it's a little bit surprising. You know, aside from some Greek city-states, and then the past couple of hundred years, in the Western world at least, democracy's been pretty rare. Could it be that, for most of at least Western history, our governments have been illegitimate? They've been ones that we shouldn't listen to, that we have no reason to support. So, why? Why would people think that? All right. Some basic points about democracy. Democracy is rule by the people. I am not a scholar of Greek, but if I understand it correctly, this is basically the root. Demos, people, and the crassy predicate it basically is a system of rule. So autocracy, rule by one. Democracy, rule by the many, rule by the demos, or the people. The core idea, what binds together all different sorts of things that people mean by democracy, the core idea is usually something like majority decision-making by the citizens. If you don't have something like that, you probably don't have a democracy. But this is really, really thin, right? This is basically just a procedural rule. There's all sorts of systems we could have that have majority decision-making by citizens that vary wildly from each other. What if you have a polity that treats only people of a certain race, or only people with property, or only people of a certain gender as citizens, right? You get something like some of the Greek city-states. What if you have majority decision-making, but you have an extremely limited set of options that you're allowed to choose from? There's a lot of variety included in that, and just saying that a system has majority decision-making doesn't really tell you that much about it. So often, when people talk about democracies, they have in mind a variety of other institutional or constitutional protections for the citizens. So, people will often say things like that increasing the scope of citizenry, allowing more people to count as citizen, increases the democratic nature of a system. People will often talk about things like a right to a fair trial, or rights of free association, rights of free speech as being integral to a democracy. And when people talk about political systems that are only apparent democracies, or that are false democracies, or pseudo-democracies, often what they mean is that they lack some of these other institutional features. So, for instance, people will point out, sometimes people will point out, look, before the 2003 U.S. invasion of Iraq, people voted for who was going to be president. It's just that, you know, there's usually only one candidate. Voting was not undertaken in a particularly free and fair environment. I mean, there was only one candidate, but you could vote no, right? You had an option. But voting was not undertaken in a particularly free and fair environment. There were a lot of pressures on voting. Having a choice up or down on one person is not the same necessarily as having a wide variety of choices. And so a lot of people would say, well, okay, so they had voting in Saddam Hussein's Iraq, but it wasn't really a democracy. Similar thing you might say about a lot of countries. I mean, in fact, the popularity of democracy, and in fact, in particular, probably the popularity of being able to call yourself a democracy with wealthy Western nations has led lots and lots of countries that many people do not consider quote-unquote real democracies to have some sort of elections, some sort of voting, some sort of appearance of majority rule. The other phrase you'll sometimes hear here, Fareed Zakaria used it in his very popular book a few years back, The Future of Freedom, is a distinction between liberal and illiberal democracy. And so sometimes people will use the phrase illiberal democracy to refer to systems that may have voting, and may even have, in some sense, free voting, at least in the sense that, you know, nobody is putting a gun to your head and making you vote for one thing or the other. Nobody is going to come roust you out of bed if you don't vote for the right candidate. But they don't have all sorts of other protections. They don't have freedom of speech, they don't have freedom of association, that sort of thing. Versus liberal democracies, where to call something a liberal democracy is to say that it has a broad range of these other kinds of political protections that are understood by a lot of people to enhance the quality of the democracy. The last thing, of course, is that modern democracies, the kind of democracies you see in the real world now, are generally not what's sometimes called direct democracies. In a country like the United States, voting directly on some policy by means of a referendum is the exception rather than the rule. In most large modern democracies, there is a significant degree of both representative structure and federal, and often federalized structure. U.S. of course has a very federalized structure, other countries not so much, but almost every, I say almost, but let me just say, every modern industrialized democracy, large democratic nation state, large democratic state, is a representative democracy. We vote for representatives. We use our majority rule to select representatives in various capacities, and then they decide on the actual policies. One thing to keep in mind, just as a side note about this, is when thinking about this, read the notion of a representative fairly broadly. So certainly my senator, ideally, is supposed to represent me. My representative in the House of Representatives is supposed to represent me. But in a different way, the president also is my representative. He's supposed to represent me. Members of the bureaucracy in some way are supposed to represent me. They take actions on my behalf in my name. Members of the military, other folks involved in the government are representatives in this broader sense. So, what are some of the big issues with democracy? This is some of the gone through some of the main points. What are some of the big questions and concerns? The first is trying to nail down what exactly democracy is. To some extent, this is a terminological question. To some extent, as long as you know what someone using the word means, you can deal with it. But to another extent, because there is often made the claim that democracy is good, or democracy is the best way of organizing a polity, or democracy is the only legitimate way of organizing a polity, it's important for us to think about what concept of democracy is able to do the various bits of work that are asked of it. If someone says that only having a democracy could make a state legitimate, could make it the case that you morally ought to, generally speaking, obey the rules of the state, support the state, what kind of democracy grounds that? Anything? Anytime you have a vote? Do you need some institutional protections? Do you need lots of institutional protections? Are there particular institutional protections that need to be in a concept of democracy that could do this legitimation work? what exactly do we mean? The second set of questions basically come down to the fact that you'll see a lot of people talk about democracy as if it is clearly the best, but it's a reasonable question. What makes democracy so good? Why is it that so many people, so many theorists especially, and also just regular everyday people, think that democracy is such a wonderful way of organizing your state, right? Most random people in America, if you grab them off the street and said, hey, do you think democracy is good? They would say, yeah. You know, if you were in a polite conversation about politics and you said, I'm just not that convinced that democracy is a good way to organize the, to organize a country, right? In the U.S., most people would give you a look if you did that. But why? Why is it supposed to be so good? One question about this is, what exactly is it supposed to do? How does turning a state into a democracy make it better? How does having a democracy make it good? What exactly does a democracy do for you that makes it so wonderful and valued? A second question, the second two questions really have to do with intuitive objections to the concept of democracy and to the value of democracy, both of which you could call, roughly speaking, elitist objections. But they're ones that I think actually have a lot of grip on people. So the first one is, why would democracy be good when all of those stupid people who don't agree with me get to vote also, right? This doesn't have to be just, oh, I think people who don't agree with me are stupid, though that's a fairly common sentiment if we're being honest. It could be something like, you could reflect on the fact and say, look, I am going to have a Master of Public Policy degree. You're going to spend 2 years learning a whole lot about how to run governments effectively. Many of you, if all goes well, will spend your careers working on learning about how to govern things effectively. Why should you have only as much say as somebody who has no idea about any of this? Right? Why is it that you, with all of your knowledge, your vote, your opinion should count only as much as somebody who's going to vote just because they like a candidate's tie, right? You can even divide it up further. So all of you will become experts in some very particular area, right? If you're an expert on environmental policy, you become extremely expert on protecting vulnerable habitats of mud skippers from development, right? You could spend a career on something like that. What makes you any more qualified than some yahoo off the street to decide whether or not we should go to war with Iran? What makes that yahoo on the street gets to vote too, right? So there's this sort of question about democracy. Why is it that we would be so excited about a system that lets lots of people who have no idea what they're talking about have a say? And a different, slightly different version of a very similar kind of concern is you'll often see concerns about what is called, the term comes from Mill, as far as I know originally, the tyranny of the majority, where the basic concept of a democracy is that majority rules, right? The sort of the core concept that underlies all the different varieties is that you have some sort of system where what the majority of the people want typically is what gets done. But we have all sorts of historical examples where what the majority of people wanted was something really bad, right? Majority of Americans at a particular time in history wanted slavery and then Jim Crow laws, right? Why is it that we should get so excited about a system that seems to give free rein to what the majority wants, even when the majority wants something that is bad or wrong? And finally, even if we do ultimately conclude that democracy is good, there's a question about whether or not there's a right to democracy. Whether it's just something good that would be nice for people to have, or whether there is some obligation to not stand in the way of people having a democracy, possibly even to help them have a democracy. Of course, the big lurking question here that we'll get to is, could it possibly be right or even obligatory to engage in conquest, to use military force to create democracies where there aren't ones already? Okay, so let's start with what is democracy. There's a broad range of things that people have proposed, a broad range of theories. In a lot of this, there's a little bit of a blend between people talking about what concept of democracy they think is a meaningful, understandable concept, and what kind of democracy they think is good. To some extent, almost everyone would recognize the other concepts of democracy as concepts of democracy, as sort of varieties on the theme. Usually when people are proposing some concept or other, it's because they think it's the best variety. It's the kind of variety that we ought to support that does the good things we want democracy to do. So, roughly speaking, it's probably too simplistic to put them on a one-dimensional spectrum, but roughly speaking, you can think of concepts of democracy as running from, on the one end, what are often called minimalist concepts of democracy that amount to not a whole lot more than people get to vote, through maximalist concepts of democracy that require lots of institutional protections and lots of robustness in the procedures that surround voting to count as full-blooded democracy. So, minimalists say, look, what democracy is any system where you've got reasonably fair periodic elections. You know, it's not like they don't care about fairness at all. It's just a recognition that you're never going to have something that's you're never going to have a real system that's perfectly fair, where there are no irregularities, nothing bad happens. You have periodic elections with genuine competition. So, you know, you have two or three or however many candidates for your representative position, and it's genuinely a competition between those candidates, right? Nobody gets to use the army to force you to vote for them. Nobody gets to use the state television station to bombard you with propaganda. The election's not rigged in any obvious way, right? There's no voter fraud or voter blocking or this sort of thing. Okay. This permits, though, a lot of stuff, right? Even though, you know, it's not complete carte blanche. It's not anytime you have a vote, you're a democracy, right? The vote has to be genuine to some extent. It permits a lot of things that a lot of people are uncomfortable with, that a lot of theorists find distasteful. One thing is, it certainly permits elite control, right? So, I make jokes a lot about how old I am compared to you guys, but some of you may remember, back, he still runs as far as I know, but especially back in 2000 and 2004, Ralph Nader ran for the presidency of the U.S. as the Green Party candidate, and a big part of his rhetoric was that, look, there's no real choice between the Democratic and Republican candidates. Both of them, in both cases, both of them come from the political and economic elite. Both of them share a huge number of assumptions about how economic policy should work, how military policy should work, how the government in general should look, right? You know, especially in 2000, though it turns out that Bush ended up being considered a very right-wing president, in 2000, watching the debates, people would make fun of how many times Al Gore and George W. Bush would agree with each other, right? Even though Democrats in the U.S. are associated with large government, right? Al Gore was Bill Clinton's VP, so he was in charge of a program to shrink government and make it more efficient. So there's certainly something. You don't have to believe that Ralph Nader would have been a wonderful president to recognize that there's certainly something to his critique. Though there were real differences between the candidates in 2000, 2004, 2008, in a lot of ways they had more similarities than differences, right? It's despite the rhetoric, it's not as if in any of those elections one guy was a fascist and the other guy was a Marxist, right? They were both basically different flavors of liberalism on display. For a minimalist Democrat, this is absolutely not a problem. Right, there's sort of an intuitive feel that maybe there's something problematic with that. That's what gets Ralph Nader support. But for a minimalist, this is absolutely not a problem. All that matters is that you have genuine competition. It doesn't matter if the competition is between two pretty similar candidates, as long as you genuinely, you know, you have a choice, and whichever choice the majority makes will win. Many minimalists have said, at least, though they usually don't say this is good, they've usually at least said that the concept is consistent with limited franchise. So many minimalists would say, though they wouldn't necessarily say it's a good thing, they would say, look, a country that doesn't allow its women to vote can still count as a democracy, as long as there's a genuine competition that all the men get to vote in, or whatever. It's also compatible with a fairly broad array of restrictions on civil liberties. It's compatible with restrictions on freedom of association. It's compatible with at least some restrictions on freedom of speech. It's certainly compatible with all sorts of restrictions on things like protest. So, on this view of democracy, to be a democracy does not require that you have lots and lots of what people often think of as being associated with democracies. So, a minimalist democracy could be a place where the elections are dominated by a fairly small elite who have ties with, you know, a fairly small political elite who have ties with the economic elite, where, you know, no one's going to put a gun to your head, but you are, you know, you have to pick from the choices that these elites give you, where there's not a lot of space for people to join the elites. That could all count as a democracy. Basically, you could have sort of, you know, the caricature of what lefty types think the U.S. is, and that's not at all a problem for the minimalist Democrats. Now, this might all sound kind of cynical and dystopian, but there are certain advantages that are claimed for this. One advantage that people often claim is that it's a pretty simple definition, right? We don't get into, if this is our definition of democracy, we don't get into lots of fights about who's a real democracy and who isn't. The bar's really low. As long as no one's putting a gun to your head and you have genuine competitions, you count as a democracy. And for theoretical purposes, you know, it might be handy to have a simple definition. This is why, for instance, though Zakaria did not endorse minimal democracies, the definition he used for the word democracy was a fairly minimalist one, to basically say, look, we don't want to have the fights about who counts as a democracy. We can have fights about whether they're nice, whether you want to live there, but it simplifies fights about who counts as a democracy. One sort of more normative advantage of this that has been claimed, Posner certainly claims this for it, is that it makes pretty minimal demands on citizens. If your socio-political ideal is a world where, for the most part, most citizens don't have to care about politics, then minimalist democracy is pretty attractive, right? This, I think, does actually explain some of the appeal of how... This, I think, is fairly intuitively plausible looking at the situation of modern industrial democracies, right? You have some people who go work for the Green Party who complain a lot about there not being real choice in government, but you have a large number of people who are more or less happy as long as nothing extreme happens, and they basically just want to be left alone. So having a situation where not much is asked of the individual citizen because things are controlled by the political elites for the most part, you know, that can be fairly attractive, right? Not everyone cares about politics. Not everyone wants to have to care about politics. Nonetheless, this sort of system is supposed to be able to prevent at least the worst excesses of the political elites. So the idea would be, as long as the folks in power are more or less doing reasonable kinds of things, then most people will be perfectly happy just to sort of go along and get along, not worry too much about getting involved in politics. New political entrepreneurs will not engage in the efforts necessary to become electable, that sort of thing. But certainly if any politician does something that's really egregiously against the grain of what the polity wants, you can vote them out of office, right? So elites get a lot of control over the day-to-day. over specific policies in this kind of system. There'll be a lot of power in the permanent bureaucracy in a modern kind of democratic state. But at the end of the day, if somebody gets elected and says, look, Marxism tomorrow, and this is out of line with what everybody in the country wants, they get to kick them out. And that's still available because of the genuine competition. All right. Prominent defenders of this, a fellow named Schumpeter, wrote a book called Capitalism, Socialism, and Democracy. And Richard Posner, my favorite libertarian, who is a judge on the Seventh Circuit Court, wrote a book called Law, Pragmatism, and Democracy, outlining a minimalist definition and then defending a minimalist definition of this. On the other side of the spectrum, you've got, well, maximalist definitions of democracy. These sorts of maximalists, when they talk about democracy or about real democracy or true democracy or deep democracy, they usually mean that there'll be some sort of elections, but also extensive institutional support for things like making sure that every citizen gets equal input, making sure that public policy is discussed deeply and broadly in the society before it's adopted, making sure that as many stakeholders as possible are included in the decisions. So the ideal is basically that everyone in the society has a right to be very thoroughly involved in the decisions that are made collectively. And even in a representative democracy, that there's large numbers of avenues for people to debate issues, make their voice heard to their representatives, interact with their representatives, hold their representatives accountable, become representatives themselves, you know, devolve as many decisions down to the public as you can, you know, get them out of the representative system if you're able to, is often one thing that deliberative Democrats want to do. Anyway, and because of this focus on sort of getting everyone involved and making decision making more than just, you know, checkbox A or checkbox B, which is all that the minimalist requires of democracy, making it into a process where everyone's voice is heard and where we strive to sort of come together to make collective decisions. Sometimes this will be, you'll hear this called either deliberative democracy or participatory democracy as an ideal. So, advantages are basically what they look like. It's inclusive. If you succeed in this, you get everyone involved as much as humanly possible. It strives to be egalitarian. It strives to make sure that you don't have to be a member of the political or economic elite to have your voice heard. And one advantage often claimed is that this kind of system promotes deep compromise. So in a more minimalist system, you might have log-rolling compromises where I walk in, I want A, you want B, and we agree, okay, we'll do a little bit of A and a little bit of B so that we can stop fighting, right? Or we'll do A today and we'll do B tomorrow, and we'll trade off that way. Neither of us change our position. You still think A is stupid, I still think B is crap. We just agreed to do things to get along. Deliberative Democrats often want something more out of public discussion of the issues, or out of deliberations in the legislatures. The idea behind a deep compromise is that through talking with each other, through coming to understand each other's positions, through hashing out why we disagree and what other options there might be, and how we can best respect each other, we'll be better able to come to situations where we make a compromise, but the compromise is not just everybody gets a little bit of what they want, everyone is equally dissatisfied, but the compromise is one where we can all say, ah, I wholeheartedly support that conclusion. Maybe even I think that conclusion is even better than the one that I started with. So this would be the kind of ideal where I, you know, come in wanting A, you come in wanting B, we talk about it a lot, and we realize, ah, there's this option C that actually does all of what we both want and that we can now agree on. Often, especially for participatory Democrats, often the ideal is considered to be consensus rather than voting. Voting is sometimes treated as the way you make decisions under the time pressures of the real world, where consensus is not always possible. But in the ideal, you would reach consensus or even unanimity. And that's what you're striving for. You're striving towards mutual understanding and convergence. All right, disadvantages of this. One is, the basic one is that it's extremely demanding of institutions and individuals. In this sort of ideal, this is the kind of ideal of democracy where everyone is going to town hall meetings a lot, right? Where everyone is spending a lot of their time being involved with politics. Because you know, it's not enough to just have a system that says, okay, yeah, anyone can participate if they want to, but then there's various pressures on people that end up with them not participating, or people choose not to participate even if there's not pressure on them. This kind of system requires that people actually be involved in the decision making, and you know, the minimalists will say, look, we've all got lives. I don't want to go to political meetings in the evening, right? I want to stay home and watch TV. Or I don't want to go to political meetings in the evening. I want to improve my business or whatever. But these sorts of participatory systems, they demand participation. Ironically, there have also been accusations that even though these kinds of approaches strive to be egalitarian, they end up being elitist. The basic problem is this. Especially when you think about the deep compromise side of things, the model, especially for a lot of the deliberative Democrats, the model of democracy really looks a lot like discussions in the lounge of a philosophy department. The requirements on conversation that a lot of deliberative Democrats think are ideal are ones that in the real world may be problematic for some people. So deliberative Democrats often place a very high value on excluding emotion, excluding bias, making sure that you have all of the facts, making sure that you follow closely to canons of reasoning, that you appeal only to reason. You don't appeal to emotion. And so some have argued that this actually creates a situation that has high barriers to entry for a lot of people, especially for people who are poorer or less educated. It's really easy in a conversation like the one that deliberative Democrats sometimes seem to be envisioning, for someone who is trained in the kind of conversations that philosophers like to dominate, especially if you are barring people who are using other kinds of approaches. So the kind of concern is basically this, that you know, you're having a conversation about some sort of policy, and someone who is directly affected by the policy may be poorer, may not have spent a zillion years studying formal logic, may get angry. And the deliberative Democrats are basically saying, no, look, you can't get angry. I know. Our policy, if we adopt policy A, it will lead to your house being knocked down. But no, you're getting very upset. I think you should leave. Right. This is the kind of problem that some people have seen with the deliberative ideal, is that it enforces a kind of ideal of dialogue that not only is characteristic of, if not the economic elite, at least the educational elite in a lot of countries, and can be very difficult to access, can be very easy to exclude people from in the name of civility. While it strives for, the reason for wanting to do things like exclude emotion is to strive for egalitarianism, right? The idea behind it is that you don't want demagogues to be able to whip up the population into a frenzy and make decisions based on that. But ironically, the concern is that this may have the perverse effect of actually excluding people who are not trained in the specific canons of discussion that that deliberative Democrats take for granted. Anyway, some interesting discussion about that. We can talk about more about it if you guys want. But some of the prominent defenders of this, Amy Gutman and Dennis Thompson, most associated with the term deliberative democracy in philosophical circles. Archon Fung is another big defender of a kind of participatory model. Somewhat in between these things, though a little bit closer to the deliberative Democrat side, is what Dahl in the book calls polyarchy. Polyarchy is still a little bit of an ideal in that no actual democracy completely lives up to the standards of Dahl's polyarchy. But in some ways, it's a more realistic ideal. A ideal polyarchy would look like a tweaked and refined version of a modern industrial democracy, whereas a ideal deliberative democracy would, you know, look like constant town meetings and lots of workers' councils and all sorts of stuff. It would be a much more radical departure from the way we do things. So for Dahl, the advantage of talking in terms of polyarchy is that it gives us something to strive for, but it's one that lets us examine something that looks at least a little bit like what we have. If polyarchies are good, that's reason to think that the kinds of modern industrial democracies that we have are probably on the right track, at least. So, I've done everything on this slide. Looking out the window, it's a nice day. So, polyarchies have six institutional features. This is what makes something a polyarchy in Dahl's definition. And again, these are institutional features that are supposed to be characteristic of well-functioning, large, representative, industrial capitalist democracies. First, they've got elected officials and free, fair, and frequent elections, right? They share that with almost everything else that calls itself a democratic theory. They allow for freedom of expression, wide freedom of speech rights. Dahl is not absolutely clear on whether this means, you know, you can't have hate speech laws or you can't have restrictions on pornography, but broadly speaking, wide freedom of speech. And I think Dahl himself would probably fall more on the ACLU side of saying, no, you should be able, anything that's speech, you should be able to do. I don't know how Dahl feels about things like Citizens United. It's a good question. We should talk about that in class. One thing that's sort of not on the Bill of Rights, but that Dahl thinks, you know, we've been sort of doing Bill of Rights-y kind of stuff so far, but one thing that Dahl thinks is important to something counting as a polyarchy that's a little bit different is that there have to be alternative sources of information available, right? So, again, this comes on a spectrum, but the idea is that you certainly don't want state television or the state newspaper being the only source of information. There's basically needs to be competition within the field of information to try to make sure that there's a genuine, to use the Millian term, there's a genuine marketplace of ideas, right? So you need there to not just be a party line that people will get from any information source that they look to. And this especially is going to mean that you need broad range of views represented in the media and a broad range of outlets represent the media, right? So it's not enough to just have, I mean, Dahl is much more concerned with a broad range of outlets than a broad range of views. He tends to, he's in a class of thinkers who tend to think that, you know, broad range of views will happen as long as you have a broad range of outlets. If there's wide open competition for, you know, for whatever, for newspapers or for television, you know, someone will come up with the fascist television station, right? Someone will come up with the Marxist television station. Someone will come up with the neoliberal television station, right? Probably the purest expression of this in the real world is, you know, look at the internet, right? Whatever your politics are, no matter how bizarre, you could be like a Trotskyite, Raelian, Mayan prophecy 9/11 truther. I just made that up, and I bet there is some place on the internet where you could go and talk to people who have views similar to yours. There's some place on the internet where you could go and get information from your Trotskyite, Raelian, 9/11 truther perspective. So, but Dahl thinks that this is really crucial to something being a good polyarchy, precisely because control of information, and this sounds really dumb when you say it so bluntly, but control of information sources is a very powerful way of controlling the electorate, right? You can have your elections be as free and fair as you like. You know, we make sure that everyone gets election day off from work. We, you know, give them all sorts of voter education materials. We give them whatever kind of help they need to get to the polls. No one puts a gun to their head. No one even tries to strong arm them even a little. But if all of the major news outlets are spewing the same party line, well, you're going to be able to get them to vote for that party line, because the majority of people are not going to be going out and doing a lot of their own research, right? They've got other stuff to do with their lives in an actual modern democracy, right? Only a very small percentage of people devote a large chunk of their lives to independently digging up information for themselves. Okay. The last two is there has to be associational autonomy. Basically what this amounts to is that people have to be able to join groups, and whatever kind of groups that they think are pleasant or useful. Importantly, this includes things like political parties and other kinds of groups that will organize for political action, but just all sorts of groups that create social ties outside of the scope of the government, to all things, are important for a well-functioning polyarchy. They support the kind of social fabric and social life that allows people to discuss issues and then bring the fruits of that discussion to their actual political activity. And inclusive citizenship. Basically, Dahl thinks everyone who's affected by the decisions of the government should get a say. You know, not tourists, not people who are only temporarily, but anyone who's going to be here for any extended period of time and be subject to the governmental rules should have some say in what those rules are. All right, so now that we have some sense of what we're talking about when we talk about democracy, we can talk about what people have thought makes democracy good. So the first question is, well, what are we comparing it to? And there's really two major competitors in terms of thinking about how a state should be organized. The first is anarchism, and frankly, anarchism usually dismissed by theorists. You will find very few contemporary political philosophers taking anarchism seriously. Most of them take the existence of a state as the given and the legitimation of that state as the problem. Dahl, in his longer book on democracy, Democracy and Its Critics, gives a longer response to the anarchists, in particular to Robert Paul Wolff's variety of anarchism. But in On Democracy, he largely just dismisses it. In a nutshell, the form of almost any response to the anarchist challenge, right? So the anarchists are the folks who say, democracy is not good because we shouldn't have a state at all. We shouldn't have a democratic state. We shouldn't have a non-democratic state. We should have no state. We should all have, you know, individual freedom to do as we will without any kind of centralized coercive force in play. Democratic theorists who bother to respond to the concern typically give one of two kinds of answer. The first is that we need states to solve large-scale coordination problems. So this is basically the interstate highways issue. There are certain kinds of things that we need states to do to accomplish. Create large public works, is one of the main ones. And we can't do that without empowering some central authority to compel us to obey the rules, because otherwise you end up with a coordination problem, right? If you say, for instance, we need to protect the environment, right? Here's a public good, environmental protection. The argument would be that you can't do this on a purely voluntary basis. Because for each one of us, and this is the prisoner's dilemma for those of you who know it, for each one of us, it's going to be individually rational for us to, you know, use whatever oil we can, burn stuff, not recycle, and whatnot. And the reason is that if the environment is saved, all of us get to benefit. And my individual contribution to environmental degradation is so small as to make no difference in the long run on its own, right? If other people continue to pollute, then if I recycle, doesn't matter. Armageddon is still coming. On the other end, you know, if everybody goes green and I continue to drive my SUV around and throw my McDonald's wrappers on the ground, I'm kind of a dick, but, you know, me alone, I'm not going to wreck the environment. So the costs of contributing are relatively high, and I get the benefit whether I contribute or not. So, you know, nobody contributes, and then the environment tanks. So the first kind of argument is to say, well, we need states to create certain kinds of large-scale public goods. Anarchists will say, no, you don't, but that's at least the form of the argument. The other form of the argument, a form of argument you'll often see, is the argument that in a world without a state exercising coercive force, in particular police force, you would have individuals who didn't care about morality basically marauding across the countryside. So basically the idea is that if there were no state to enforce the rules, sure, you would be free of the state, but you wouldn't be free of other assholes who wanted to come and take your stuff because they happen to have more guns or more stronger or whatever, right? This is basically kind of the Hobbesian argument against the anarchists. And again, anarchists will say, no, that's not what would happen, but that's the kind of argument that Democrats will usually give against the anarchists. On the other side, you've got varieties of what Dahl calls guardianship. And this is basically any kind of government that is ruled by the enlightened elite rather than rule by the mass. Guardianship, as we pointed out before, has certain intuitive attractiveness to it, right? There's something that kind of makes sense about saying, if we want to have a government that does stuff effectively, you know, maybe we should have the elite run it, right? Maybe the most educated people should run it, or the most educated in public policy should run it. Aristotle famously thought that aristocracy, rule of the best, was in fact the ideal form of government, and democracy was bad. Aristotle did think that when your government was dysfunctional, a dysfunctional democracy was the least bad of the various dysfunctional systems. But if it's working well, he thought aristocracy was clearly better, because, you know, most people don't know anything about running a state. Well, there are really two problems with any kind of guardianship, whether it's, you know, meritocratic bureaucracy or divine right of kings. The first is a motivational problem. The first is that whoever the guardian is, they have less reason to look out for your good than you do. This is pretty obvious, right? The king has really good reasons to look out for what's good for the king. You know, his reasons to look out for what's good for you are, you know, maybe he cares, maybe he's compassionate, right? Or maybe he's worried about you overthrowing him. But, you know, things can get pretty bad for you before you overthrow the king. So it's not clear that the guardians are going to be motivated to look out for the rest of us. The other problem is that even if you were to assume that the guardians were saints, they're philosopher kings, they're perfectly, they care only about doing what's best for the society. They care only about maximizing the welfare of all. Even if you assumed that, they may not have the right perspective to know what's good for you, right? Think about some of the complaints about Mitt Romney, right? When you talk about, when people say, oh, Mitt Romney, he's out of touch, right? He's too rich. They're not saying he's stupid, right? You probably need to be reasonably smart to get as rich as Mitt Romney is, right? They're not even necessarily saying he's evil. You know, you hear this complaint from among Republicans, right? It would be most Republicans, most Americans in general, but certainly most Republicans don't think that being rich makes you bad. What they're saying is something like, even if he's trying to look out for the little guy, he's not going to do it right because he doesn't know what's good for the little guy. He's going to give them, you know, Mitt Romney, the complaint, the criticism, the concern is that Mitt Romney, if he were president, even if we assume that he's totally, totally nice guy, heart's in the right place and everything, he's going to give poor people and even middle class people in the U.S. what rich people think middle class people want, not what middle class people actually want. So, and then the other part of this is that just being the guardians, just being the political elites, will tend to insulate you from the concerns and the understanding of the everyday, right? Especially if you are a career bureaucrat, It doesn't matter how meritocratic the bureaucracy is. It doesn't matter how enlightened you are. It doesn't matter how moral and motivated to do good for everyone you are, right? People are still going to accuse you of having an inside the beltway perspective, and they're going to be right, at least to some extent. People who spend their lives and careers in Washington, D.C. don't see things the way that other people do all the time. So democracy is good, Dahl thinks. Democracy is better than guardianship, Dahl thinks, because he thinks that no matter what other attractions guardianship may seem to have, superior knowledge of the guardians, right, that sort of thing, it will be outweighed by the fact that in a real situation, the guardians will tend to care more about themselves than about the people. And even when they care about the people, they will tend to not have as good an understanding of what's good for the people as the people will themselves. So a system like polyarchy, where the people broadly get to have input into the system, where they get to hold whoever the officials are accountable if they don't do what they want, where they get to make known how they see things, Dahl thinks that the trade-off to lose the control of specialized knowledge in order to get that kind of input is going to be much superior in outcome. All right. Dahl gives a pretty typical list of advantages for democracy. I'm not going to go into great detail on all of them here. Most of them are fairly straightforward, but I'll at least run down them. Well, let me at least give you some highlights. Running down them when I already have them on the slide seems kind of silly. A few interesting things. All right. Preventing autocracy that's kind of definitional. Granting more individual freedoms. Some of this is part of the voting part of it, and some of it's part of the institutional part of it. Obviously, freedom of speech is an individual freedom that's protected. But note that, for instance, Dahl's structure doesn't explicitly include much about economic freedoms. But associational autonomy will tend to lead to that, Dahl thinks, and will tend to protect itself by allowing people to vote, right? Most people will not vote away their ability to engage in their own kind of productive and consumptive activities. A couple things that might bear noting. One is maximizes self-determination. Dahl and a lot of democratic theorists actually think that democracy does this in two ways, and polyarchic democracy, for Dahl, does this in two ways. One is, of course, part of my self-determination is my ability to participate in the communal life, right? Part of what it means for me to be self-determining is to be subject to a government that makes laws that I've had a say in. So that's one side of the increase, of the maximization. The other side of it, the claim is that in my personal non-political life, my self-determination will also be maximized because, or at least maximized to the extent compatible with other things that people care about, because I have plenty of ability in a polyarchy to stop the government from interfering with me, even for my own good. If I don't think it's for my own good, I can vote against it, right? The guardians, and this is sort of the very common criticism against liberals in the US, right? They want to ban trans fats and bacon and violent movies and this sort of thing, right? And the idea is that the guardians may be very well intentioned and think, look, you'll be better off without your violent movies and bacon. But you know that bacon is delicious, and so you will vote against the anti-bacon laws. You know that Bruce Willis is awesome, and so you will vote for the pro-violent movie laws, so that you can protect your own sphere of individual freedom better than a guardian would. And, you know, Dahl would say even better than you could under anarchy. Right, because under anarchy, the police won't come. If I come to your house and steal your bacon, the police will not come. There's a pun in there somewhere. But anyway, whereas in a polyarchy, that you will vote to have police that will protect those sorts of freedoms. Another interesting couple things, and Dahl picks this up from Mill in a lot of ways, is the idea that polyarchy develops your own moral responsibility and your own development as a human being. The idea is that in a more minimalist system, it's easy for you as an individual just not to care about stuff. It's easy for you as an individual not to take responsibility for things, right? Take, for instance, this is probably a contentious issue, so fill in a different example if you've got a better one. Take, for instance, debates about the wars that the U.S. is currently involved with, right? It is a very common sentiment in the U.S., especially now that that Obama has not lived up to the hopes of some of his more ardently anti-war supporters, right? There were a lot of people who thought, you know, Obama was going to take office and then immediately we would get out of all of our engagement in Iraq and Afghanistan. There is a fairly common sentiment among Americans that, you know, well, what are you going to do, right? The government's going to be at war. Doesn't matter whether Obama or Romney or Santorum or whoever ends up winning the election in 2012, we're still going to be in Afghanistan. We're still going to have diplomatic security in Iraq, even though we don't have any folks out. We're probably still going to do, you know, drone strikes on people. And so for a lot of Americans, that sort of thing is sort of regarded as, you know, out of your control. And as a result, a lot of people don't feel responsible for it. Right? When, you know, when drone strikes kill civilians, or even when they kill combatants, right? When things like the horrible thing with the U.S. soldier killing 17 Afghan civilians happen, a lot of people regard that not as something I did or I had a hand in, but as something, you know, the government did. And Dahl says this really stunts our moral responsibility to live in a system where we, in a lot of ways, quite reasonably, don't take responsibility for those things. It sort of morally infantilizes us. And so Dahl, and he really follows John Stuart Mill here, thinks that a democracy, a polyarchic democracy, one where, you know, you have to pay attention, where you are genuinely given options for, you know, for promoting things that you want and that you think are good, will foster people being more morally responsible. And at the end, so that's the human development, moral development kind of thing. And, you know, at the end, there's a couple of practical benefits a lot of people have claimed for democracy. A lot of you will be familiar with the democratic peace hypothesis, the idea that democracies don't go to war with each other, and or at least much more rarely go to war with each other than... It turns out democracies go to war with non-democracies a lot, but they don't go to war with each other. So, you know, war generally is bad. You know, it might be justifiable, we'll get to that, but, you know, it's not a good thing. It's not yay war for most people. So, yeah, if every country became a polyarchy, maybe we would just not have wars anymore. Dahl follows a lot of democratic theorists in thinking that the combination of democracy with capitalism is a powerful engine for prosperity. And, you know, I like prosperity. Most people like prosperity. You know, China is one of the big challenges. Well, China and environmental collapse are the two big challenges to this, right? It remains to be seen whether China can be as economically prosperous as the Western democracies without really being democratic politically. It also remains to be seen whether, you know, we're riding a resource wave and we're all gonna crash from overconsumption and environmental degradation. But it is a fairly common view that historically the combination of democracy with market economies has been both mutually reinforcing in terms of stability and a powerful engine for making people better off in their personal lives, healthier, wealthier, able to buy more iPads, that sort of thing. So, one question is whether democracy, even if it's good, even if we accept that democracy is good, even if we accept that it's the best, you know, it's ideally better than any other kind of system, it's a question about whether it's good for everyone. The political scientist side of this question is the question of whether or not it's stable everywhere, whether it's possible everywhere. You know, if you could go and create a democracy in some arbitrary place, would everyone say, finally, wow, democracy, great, and, you know, It's just a matter of there being obstacles in its way, or there are some places where democracy is not going to work or is not going to work yet. Most folks, most political philosophers don't believe a lot of the views about what's incompatible with democracy that's out there, right? You'll be hard-pressed to find a political philosopher who will say, oh, you know, democracy is incompatible with Islam, or even, you know, even democracy is incompatible with a certain level of sort of left or right ideology within range. But there are structural things that Dahl, along with a lot of other political philosophers and political scientists, think need to be in place in order to have a democracy, at least one that looks like our sort of imperfect industrial polyarchies. One is you need to have civilian control of security. So police and military need to be under civilian control. You can't have a general also be the president, or else you end up with military domination of the government. There's some interesting sort of corner cases, you know, what about Turkey? Turkey's got issues about civilian control, and yet at the same time the military sees itself as the guarantor of democracy in Turkey. But for the most part, most theorists think that you need civilian control of the military. You need people to believe in democracy. This is the closest that folks come to the kind of Islam is not compatible with democracy sorts of views. And it seems fairly straightforward. Whatever else people believe, you need them to believe that democracy is a good thing. If people don't believe, if most of the people in your state don't believe in democracy, they won't promote it, they won't participate, they won't protect it, and democracy will collapse into some kind of elite rule rather than staying democratic, most likely. This is a very practical one. You need to not have some other country that doesn't like democracy there, right? Whatever else is going on in Saudi Arabia, it would be really hard for democracy to take root there so long as, you know, the US and the UK and other folks support the House of Saud. You know, there might be incremental reforms that get pushed for, but if you have a strong outside power that is thwarting democracy, yeah, it's probably not going to work for obvious reasons. Dahl thinks that you need a market economy and reasonable wealth. Part of this is purely historical. Part of this is purely Dahl saying, looks like there have not been lots of examples where either a modern-style democracy has survived without there being a basically market economy. And similarly, he thinks there aren't really a lot of examples of market economies that have survived without there being a democracy. To some extent, he doesn't have a theory of why this is, and there's some interesting debate about whether this is necessary, whether it's just the way things have worked out, or what. But Dahl, more or less, and a lot of other folks are going to say, look, it just hasn't worked, so don't play with fire. And you will see some other folks arguing that they do go hand in hand on a more conceptual level. So people who think that China will inevitably politically liberalize believe that this will happen largely because they say, look, you can't have economic freedom without pressures toward political freedom. You can't have a well-functioning market economy because in a well-functioning market economy, right, like people need information flow. And China, for instance, is having a lot of trouble trying to throttle information about democracy while allowing the kind of information that businesses need to work to flow freely. Also, as people become more economically free, if they're not also politically free, they're going to press for those sorts of things. They're not going to ultimately be satisfied with, you can buy as many big screen TVs as you want, but you have to vote for the, you know, you have to vote for the Communist Party. On the flip side, the argument is usually that you actually more often see the argument that markets inevitably lead to democracy than the other way around. But on the flip side, you will see arguments basically saying, look, if people have political democracy, they will want to use that to preserve a zone of freedom in terms of what they do for their work, what they buy, what they consume, how they live their lives on a personal level. And so political democracy will lead to pressure for economic liberalism. And finally, this is the most technical one that Dahl has, though I think even though not everyone would put it this way, there's a real grip to this, is what Dahl calls weak subcultural pluralism. And so this is a little bit of a you know, not too hot, not too cold kind of notion. The idea is that you can't have a completely atomized and monolithic society and have a democracy be sustained, right? That's a recipe for totalitarianism, to have no one have any private or social associations whatsoever, right? That's not going to work. But on the other hand, you can't have sub-state loyalties that are so strong that people care more about their sub-state associations, their sub-national associations, than they do about the unity of their whole system, right? That's a recipe for the state breaking up. So the idea is that you need, in order to sustain the kind of politico-cultural life that allows people to really have an effective voice, to form associations and this sort of thing, you need there to be some subcultural pluralism. You need there to be various kinds of groups people can join in the society, various kinds of identities besides just citizen that people have. But you need it to not be too strong as to pull the whole state apart. Okay, a couple other concerns about democracy being good for everyone, right? Even aside from making sure that possibly these practical things are in place to make sure that it will survive. One is that though there is this democratic peace hypothesis, democracy might be good for stability, but democratization is often destabilizing, as any kind of large-scale change is destabilizing, both internally, and there's some evidence that democratizing countries go to war with their neighbors more often than if they just stayed. And the idea is basically that if you have a stable autocracy, it may not be great, but people can kind of predict it. If you have a stable democracy, wonderful. That's the ideal for a lot of theorists. But the change can be dangerous and destructive. And so, you know, it may not be a good idea to have every country undergo that kind of change, depending on the other parts of the situation. It may be more important to keep it safe and stable, even for the benefit of its own people, arguably, than to cause it to democratize. And finally, there's this question, the million question on intervention, about whether or not democracy can be imposed. You know, the U.S. has been engaged to a large extent in a 10-year, more than 10-year, but 10-year in the current phase experiment, and whether or not this can work. The core of the million idea, to some extent, goes to this issue of the need for a widespread democratic beliefs or culture. Mill's idea is basically that if the people in some nation believed sufficiently in democracy, they would create it for themselves. And the fact that you would need to come in and bring it by force indicates that there's not the commitment to it that would sustain it there. Even if you don't have that concern, you might just think more mundanely that, you know, war, sanctions, other kinds of coercive imposing measures are quite destructive in their own right. And democracy might be good, but it may not justify engaging in those kinds of activities. All right, so to sum up, beyond the basic idea of rule by the people, there's a range of understanding of what democracy is, ranging from the minimalists on one side all the way up to the full-blooded, deliberative Democrats, participatory Democrats on the other side. Most folks, except for the real super minimalists, agree that democracy means something more than just majority rule. And the things that are good about democracy both include the kind of stuff that we often talk about in the U.S. in terms of enhancing personal freedom, but they often also include claimed benefits in terms of personal responsibility, that democracy will not just make you freer, but a lot of its defenders claim that it actually makes you a better person, because it encourages you to take responsibility for your actions, and it encourages you by giving you effective routes for responsibility, right? The easiest way to get someone to not take responsibility for their actions is to render their actions meaningless. But democracy creates a space in which people's actions actually mean something, and so people will take responsibility for them. And, unfortunately, even if you think it's good, it may be the case that democracy is not sustainable or appropriate in every single situation on Earth. Though there's a long and questionable legacy of that idea that we can talk about more. See you soon.